Okay, so thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me to give this presentation. I'm going to describe work that we have been doing in the last few years in my group with my current and past students, Mehdi Alizade, Ramin Rashiperchikolai, Max Vladimirov, and Weran Wang. And Ramin might be sitting somewhere in the audience. Okay, so this work is going to be about optimization, not that much about neural networks per se, but about optimization of deep systems, neural networks, and are just one example of them. Here is an outline of what I'm going to be talking about. There are going to be two parts in the presentation. I will be skipping over things because I'm not going to have time to talk about everything. In the first part, which is all this, I will describe what a deep system, nested system is, and the various ways that you can train this. I will introduce the method of auxiliary coordinates, which I'm going to be talking about today. And then in the second part of the presentation, I will describe a number of different models that you can train in this way. Okay, so I'm going to be using mostly the term nested for what everybody here calls deep. Nested is the mathematical form of a function that is a function of a function and so on. So neural networks are like an example of that. There are lots of systems of this type in computer vision, speech processing, machine learning, etc., such as object recognition pipelines that you're familiar with. In speech, you have similar things. In machine learning, you also have things that are not recognized as deep, but classify an image, you may pipe that into something that reduces the dimensionality. Typically, people do PCA, and then that itself, the output of that goes into another function, which may be a classifier, and then that outputs the label that you want. So right there, you have something that has multiple layers of processing. And of course, and you can also do the same to take an image and project it to some space, truncate the output into bits. You have a string of bits that then you go and use to search in a database, as in binary hashing. And then you also have deep nets. So all these systems, what they share mathematically is that they are nested functions. They construct a sequence of functions, each of which is parametric, and if you want to optimize the whole function towards some overall objective, such as, for example, classification error, then you should be optimizing every one of these layers. The parameters in every one of these layers, which may be weights in each layer of the neural net, or it may be the linear projection followed by the classifier that you have. Okay, so now I want to introduce the difference between shallow and deep systems. A shallow system is something that is just one function or maybe one or two functions. There are many examples of this also in machine learning. For example, a linear mapping, a linear SVM, a lasso, all those things go from the input to the output directly, essentially through either one layer of linear weights or something like that. They are very practically useful because they are particularly simple to train, convex and all that, so that has enabled their success in the last few years. And they also can do useful things. Even though they are relatively simple, they don't have to be linear, they can be non-linear because you can construct a nonlinear function by summing fixed nonlinear functions, and then you just train the weights. So that can be considered a shallow system in that there is really only one layer of trainable weights. Okay, and nested systems or deep systems are systems that have multiple such layers, and then you need to optimize over all of them. And this is what I'm going to be focusing on the presentation. So the problem with the reason why these systems are difficult to train is that composition of functions, applying one function after another, nearly always generates non-convexity. And non-convex problems are not only non-linear, but they are difficult to optimize in general. They have local optima, etc. So I'm going to briefly describe the typical ways that non-convex nested systems, deep systems, are trained today. There are basically two ways. The normal way is the venerable gradient backpropagation, which is just the chain rule. So layer by layer, you can compute the gradients, and then once you have the gradient over all the parameters, you feed it to a nonlinear optimizer, such as gradient descent or Newton's method or whatever, and then you work with that. Okay, so this works more or less well. And it has some disadvantages, though. One is that you need to have a differentiable function. All the layers must be differentiable. The gradient can be difficult to compute. It doesn't mean that it cannot be computed. It's just that you have to take some effort to compute it, to code it, and to debug it. This may be helped by using automatic differentiation, but not always is that a good solution. Even when you compute the gradient, you still have to do the nonlinear optimization, which is not an easy task. There are many methods, they have issues, they may be more or less slow, they have parameters to set by hand, etc. And then in some methods, in some models, you have the problem of vanishing gradients that leads to ill conditioning. Derivatives of some parameters are very small compared to and the derivatives of other parameters. And then this is also difficult to parallelize. Okay, so that's one way. That is using the chain rule to construct the whole gradient. The other way that people often train nested systems is so-called layer-wise, or sometimes filter as opposed to wrapper systems. And what this means is that you're going to fix each layer of the function sequentially and greedily. So for example, people have been doing this recently in neural networks, although it goes back to a long time, where you can fix the first layer of the neural network in a certain way. You fix the parameters, you don't touch them anymore, then given that, you go and fix the second layer, and so on. And when you have done that, that's your network. It is obviously not optimal. It didn't really optimize anything. It was a heuristic way of setting the layers, but it does work to some extent. And then later on, you can also fine-tune it if you want. But this gives you a very simple layer-wise greedy procedure to train something that is nested. Okay, so that actually has been done in machine learning for other systems which are non-neural networks, and we all are familiar with this. So for example, imagine that you want to train a classifier for face images or something like that. Then what everybody does is the image, first of all, what you do is you reduce dimensionality using PCA, and then the output of that you go and give it to a classifier. So right there you again have two layers of processing, and the first one you are not optimizing over it, you are fixing it to PCA by hand. Or instead of PCA, it could be LDA or something like that. But you're still fixing it and not optimizing jointly over all the parameters. Why? Because it is very simple and it works to some extent, but it is not optimal. So in this work, we want to follow what is sometimes called the wrapper approach. This terminology comes from the feature selection literature, where filter approach is where you select the features in some ad hoc heuristic way and then you train a classifier. While wrapper approach is the approach where you optimize over the selection and the classifier at once. Okay, so in the wrapper approach, we need to optimize over everything, and you could potentially do using the chain rule, but it will have the same problems as backpropagation. It is difficult, you need to have derivatives, etc. Requires nonlinear optimization. Okay, so also in many models, you want to do model selection once you have done the training. So that means that you have to repeat everything that I described for every choice of the model class. So for example, if you have a neural network and you want to select the number of hidden units, you have to, you say you use 100 hidden units in each layer, then you train it, and then you want to change the number of hidden units, and you train again, and you repeat. And this is extremely time consuming. It is an off-combinatorial search. And in practice, of course, what everybody does, just because there is no way to run this for much longer, is you pick a few models randomly or otherwise, and you train them and pick the best one. Okay, so this has been a very quick overview, roughly, of what a nested system is and how they are trained in practice most of the time. So nested systems, in summary, are a ubiquitous way to construct nonlinear trainable functions. They work very well. They can generate very complex functions. They also tend to be somewhat intuitive to construct. Those functions, those layers may mean something. But unfortunately, the optimization is difficult because they are non-convex, non-linear, maybe non-differentiable. I will talk about that later. And the two ways that they are usually trained are layer-wise, which is easy but suboptimal, or using backpropagation or the gradient, which is optimal. By optimal, I mean that if you let it run, eventually it will converge to a stationary point. But it is very slow and difficult to implement and needs differentiable layers. Okay, so I'm now going to introduce the method of auxiliary coordinates that we proposed a few years ago and that I'm going to be talking about. This is a way to generate algorithms that optimize nested systems without using the chain rule. So it's a general strategy to train all the parameters of a nested system. It's not an algorithm, but a meta-algorithm like expectation maximization, which means that when you have a nested system, you have to do some operations and you have to work through it a little in order to generate the algorithm for that particular problem. But I will illustrate that with various examples. It enjoys the benefits of layer-wise training. What I mean by that is that you will see that when we apply this method to various models, you end up having something that looks like layer-wise training. But it is iterated. So you do layer-wise training, and once you have done that, you do some changes, go back, and repeat. So really, the only difficulty that it offers compared to the simple way of layer-wise training is that you have to iterate that, but that's what computers are for, to do that hard work for you. And on top of that, I will show that with differentiable functions, this also converges to a local optimum or a local stationary point of your problem, of your non-convex function. Another thing that happens with this algorithm is that it parallelizes things. So the original system, which was inherently sequential because you have to go from the input to the next layer, and so on, that breaks up into layers and they become parallel. You can train them in parallel. And the basic idea of this method is you have to do several steps. In the first one, you turn the original nested problem into another problem which is constrained by introducing a lot of parameters. At first, this is going to look a little weird, but because the problem looks like it is more complicated than it should be. And those I am going to call the auxiliary coordinates. Then this constraint problem in this augmented space, we are going to optimize it by using a penalized method like the quadratic penalty or the augmented Lagrangian. And that penalized function, we are going to optimize it using alternating optimization. And that will be at the end of point three here is where you have an actual algorithm that you can implement. And as I say, it will alternate training the layers as if they were independent from each other with coordinating them using this auxiliary coordinates that I just described. Okay, so let's look at that. I'm going to explain how this works using the simplest case, which is just one layer, one hidden layer. So consider that we have, this is the input x, and then we apply first a capital F function that does something. I'm going to be completely agnostic about that. It could be a linear transformation, or it could be an entire neural network if you want. It could be anything, any function. And then the output of that goes into a second function g, which again can be anything. So you can think, for simplicity, you can think of this as being, for example, a linear transformation whose output goes into a classifier, like a logistic regression or something like that. But it could be anything. Okay, and then what we want is to optimize an objective function, which again, for simplicity, I just pick to be the least squares error, like that. But it could be some other loss, 0-1 loss, or whatever. Given some inputs x and some outputs y. Okay, so let's say that we want to optimize this over the parameters of f and g jointly. We don't want to fix g and then optimize, fix f and optimize g. That would be a layer-wise training. We want to optimize over g and f jointly, and we want to find a local minimum of this function, which, remember that these are non-convex problems, so we don't have guarantees of finding the global optimum. We are just going to try to find a local one. Okay, so first step, which is the critical one, is to introduce the auxiliary coordinates. This works like this. We are going to transform the problem that we had before, this one, which is nested. You can see the nesting here, G applies to F. We just call the output of the first layer. We are going to, there is one per data point, so that's a lot of parameters. And then we construct this problem here, which is constrained. So you can see that the objective function is the same one, but the output of f of x. So obviously this looks, we do that because this is a constrained problem, which is difficult, more difficult to optimize than a constrained one, which is true, except that you will see what happens. Okay, so then per data point, now we have one parameter here. This is a parameter with a certain dimension, the output of that layer. And there is one such parameter per data point in your training set. So this could be many parameters. And now we are going to optimize this problem in a step. And we need to optimize over the original parameters, which are in the functions f and g, and the new parameters, which are this coordinate set. This is a larger space whose solution contains the solutions of the original one. Okay, so now how do we optimize this thing? There are many ways of optimizing constraint problems, but in this case, it makes sense to use a penalty method. So penalty methods, what they do is that they bring these constraints back into the objective using a penalty. A penalty function that you can choose. For this presentation, I will mostly be talking about the quadratic penalty, and the quadratic penalty is, as the name indicates, is just the square of the violation. So here are the constraints. This ideally in the solution must be zero, but during the optimization it does not have to be. That's a critical idea to keep in mind, that you don't have to respect the constraints until the very end. Okay, so then we bring it up as a square penalty for each of the coordinates. You can see there are n of them, and we multiply times a penalty parameter mu, which has to go to infinity in the limit if you want to, for this to solve the original problem. So intuitively you can see that all that this is doing really is, when you optimize over this, if mu is very large, then this has to be small, and as you drive it to infinity, then eventually each of these constraints must be satisfied. There are no violations, your point is feasible, and at the same time you're optimizing this other thing, so that's basically why the quadratic penalty method works. Okay, instead of the quadratic penalty, you can also use the augmented Lagrangian, sometimes called ADMM, when you alternate over the penalty function. And it is almost the same as the quadratic penalty. It just has this extra term here on the Lagrange multipliers, which you can rewrite like this. So you can see that it really looks like the quadratic penalty, but instead of having this constraint here, you have this other constraint. And what the augmented Lagrangian does you, that the quadratic penalty doesn't do, is it brings you to the solution faster in general. So you should really, this is what you should really, if you want to implement this, this is going to be better than that. But because the equations are a little more complicated, and for the purposes of illustrating it, it doesn't matter, then I'm going to be focusing on the quadratic penalty. And so let's go on. Now, we still need to optimize this penalized function. So, but before doing that, in fact, what have we gained by doing this? Because as I say, we started with a problem that did not have the auxiliary coordinates. We have introduced them, we have turned the problem into constraint, and then this penalized thing, what have we gained with that? So, in effect, what has happened is, if you look at what we started with to what we have now, what has happened is that we have removed the nesting. The nesting, remember, is the cause of the non-convexity and all the problems that I described before, vanishing gradients, things like that. Now what you have is a function, originally you had a function that had a nesting of two layers, and now you have two separate functions, additively separable, and each function is shallow. Shallow in the sense that, let's say that G was a logistic regression and F was a linear function, now they are separate, they are not combined. So of course that is easier to train. They are also equally scaled and coupled. And optimizing this thing, remember that you don't have to satisfy the constraints until the very end. So what this is going to mean is that rather than following a convoluted path in the space of F and G, the parameters of F and G, which can be very nonlinear until you get to a minimizer, a local minimizer, optimizing this instead, what it is going to allow you is to take shortcuts in the augmented space and perhaps get faster to the solution, because you don't have to satisfy the constraints all the time. Eventually you have to, but not all the time. Okay, so then we are here right now, we still need to optimize that. But now because this has separated, and here you can see the coordinates where they are, then it becomes obvious how to optimize this efficiently. We are going to do alternating optimization between the coordinates that we introduced and the rest of the parameters that we had originally, which are the functions F and G. Because if we do that, then we are going to have significant decoupling happening. Okay, so here it is. Now we are going to do alternating optimization. If I fix the coordinates, which is I fix the blue symbols there, then you can see that this part and this part separate. That's where I get the layer-wise separability. In fact, it is not sequential layer-wise. They are actually independent from each other. So you can train both in parallel at the same time, and you will get exactly the same solution as if you train the first one and then the second one, because they are independent. So this is truly parallel, embarrassingly parallel. Okay, so that would be the step over the original parameters, which are these functions here, given the coordinates. So this is what gives this method most of its power. The fact that without having to do any assumption or any heuristic or any approximation, you get this layer-wise parallelism for free. And besides, it is going to work and it is going to converge to the solution that you want. I still need to do something about the auxiliary coordinates, of course. That's the now, these two problems from a square error, and here another one. But if you regard that as a black box, these are really machine learning problems that you can train using existing algorithms. For example, what is this? Let's say that G was a logistic regression. Then given this input set here, to minimize this, the only thing that you have to do is call a logistic regression solver, and that's it. You don't need to worry about computing the gradients of that or setting parameters for the line search or anything like that. Just call a logistic regression. That is what it is for, and it will be probably very well developed by somebody else. You don't need to worry about that. How about that one here? Same thing. What this is doing is mapping from some input xn to some output zn, which are fixed during this step. And imagine that this f was a linear mapping, for example. Then all that you have to do there is solve a linear system. If instead this was, let's say, a neural network, well, then go and call a GPU to train a neural network, but it is independent of everything else at this point. So much of the power of this algorithm, comes from the fact that once you have these independent layer-wise problems, which will vary from model to model, very often you don't need to do anything about them. You can call existing code for that. And by calling existing code, I mean just that you don't even have to fiddle with the algorithm or anything like that. You really just pass set and y to some executable, and it will run and solve the problem for you. Okay, so that's what I mean by layer-wise training, although it is not sequential, it is parallel. So you fit these two things as independent problems using whatever you want. Of course, you can also use the gradient here if you like. It is a simpler problem. Many times, these shallower problems are also convex, which means convex problems. Okay, so now the parameters G and F, and now we have to optimize over the coordinates. This is the harder part, whose solution depends on the particular form of those functions G and F, and it has to be solved for every problem anew. What I'm going to do is I fix G and F, and I look carefully. You see that they are set 1, for example. I have set 1, then a function of set 1 plus a function of set 2 plus a function of set n. So I have n additively separable functions. So again, I get significant parallelism for that. And the problem for each one of those coordinates has this form here, which may or may not be simple. This depends on the problem. Often it is very easy to solve this, even though it may not look like that. But even if it is not that easy, these are very small problems. The dimension of this problem is the dimension of set, which are these intermediate, let's say, activations of the hidden units or the output of the PCA or whatever. This, for one data point, that's maybe 10 or 20 values or 2 values or something. It's a very small problem. So even if this is difficult to optimize, it's very small. And you can surely optimize it efficiently. And you can do it in parallel for all coordinates. So if you have 1 million data points, that means that you have 1 million independent problems that you can solve in parallel. Okay, so these are the auxiliary coordinates. You can see that I call them like that because they help of your input. So set n is the coordinate in some intermediate space of the input xn, and set n may be lower dimensional or not. It could be anything. Okay, and then they also coordinate the layers, because earlier when I explained what a layer-wise train is, I said that first you fix the first layer, and then given that you fix the second one. If you try, you would again train the first layer, so you would not get this process. So once you do the layer-wise training, which you want to correct the coordinates in this way. Now with the new of this, it's going to solve your problem. It's going to solve it because we are doing alternative optimization on the penalty function that I may recognize the form of this. It is a proximal operator. A proximal operator generally has this form here. It has a quadratic penalty. It actually doesn't have to be quadratic, but typically it is a quadratic penalty on your parameter that you optimize over, z minus something. This is a constant. This thing here is the output of the first layer, which in this step is a constant, is a vector. And then you want to minimize that plus some other function. This function here depends on your data and your second layer function, whatever it is. It could be a logistic regression, an SVM, a classifier, who knows what. Neural network, whatever. Okay, and then the proximal operators, this value u, this onto some, we need to know is solve, that we need to solve this in some way. Now, the solution of that, you have to do it. This is the one part where things are not that straightforward. You need to sit down and solve that problem. But I have solved many of these. Some of them are very easy to solve, and they can be solved in closed form, in fact. So you don't need to iterate or anything like that. I will show that later in the second part. So nation minimization algorithm, CM, the M and the C step is the step that coordinates them, is the step that optimizes over the auxiliary coordinates. And alternating both, you solve the original problem. Okay, so now you may be thinking, isn't this the same as optimizing alternatingly over the parameters? No, because if you just do that here, if you optimize over G and F in alternation, the step over G is very easy, because it just depends on constants given here. So in fact, it would look identical to this step here. That's good. But the step over F is not simple. This is not a layer or a layer training. F is embedded inside G. You still need to take the chain rule to construct derivatives there. So that's not the same as what I am describing. I described the idea just using one layer. This generalizes in the natural way to k layers. The equations look horrible, but they are in the end doing the same thing. I'm not going to go over them. You introduce coordinates at each layer if you like. You don't have to, but in general that's what you would do. And then you're going to get a quadratic penalty function or some other penalty function here, which is going to separate over layers when you fix the coordinates, and then it is going to separate over the coordinates when you fix the layers. Okay, so this idea in general you can apply it when the original problem is constrained and in many other cases, so I will skip over that. Now, does this converge or not? Okay, so remember we are talking about convex non-convex problems here. So for those of you familiar with theorems for convex optimization, of course, you know the most that you can have is some local conditions for convergence to a stationary point. That's normally what you can expect for non-convex problems. Okay, so that's what we get in here. I'm not going to go through the details. This theorem here essentially tells you that if you optimize each of the sub-problems well, that means for each value of the penalty parameter mu, you optimize that reasonably well to within a certain tolerance, and you keep doing that, then you will converge eventually to a place which is a local stationary point of the objective function, which is what you, in general, can the most that you can hope for this kind of problems. So that means that the algorithm follows a path, which, by the way, this theorem here is assuming all the functions are differentiable, so that I can apply the KKT theorem. Saying essentially is that the algorithm follows a continuous path in the parameters of the problem, which are the w's, these are the parameters of the functions, your original parameters, and the sets, which are the coordinates. I mu, the penalty parameter that starts from somewhere and then continues and converges to a place which is a local stationary point. So for each stationary point in your problem, there will be such a local path converging to it, in the general case. And we follow that path. Practically, of course, we don't have to follow it exactly, we follow it loosely. Okay, so Here is the overall design pattern. If you want to train a system using auxiliary collisions, what you have to do is, first of all, you write your nested objective function in full, in its beautiful complexity there. Then you need to identify some expressions there of the nesting. This will be usually the outputs of each layer, although there is much freedom to do all sorts of things there. And then you introduce the auxiliary coordinates, each with an equality constraint. You have now a constraint problem. You optimize this problem using a penalty method, the quadratic penalty or the augmented Lagrangian. And then the resulting alternating optimization over the coordinates that you introduce and the parameters typically will be single layer independent problems that you can solve using existing algorithms. And the step over the coordinates is something that you need to solve by hand for your problem. But as I say, I have solved many of those. Okay, so some of you may notice that this is very similar to what you have to do with the EM algorithm. In the EM algorithm, you have your likelihood function that comes from whatever model you have. Think, for example, of operations in paper to work out certain things, the complete data likelihood, all that kind of thing, then and the EM step. So all that work has to be done by you ahead of time in paper, and it may be a complicated derivation, but at the end you end up with something that typically looks very simple. Like in the Gaussian mixture case, you alternate between training the Gaussians on its own independently from each other, given the posterior probabilities, and then you have to update the posterior probabilities, which usually is done by... So in that sense, the behavior of this okay, so here is an example training layers. It's a small neural network, somewhat deep, and here at every layer, and Newton, this is just one of many ways that you can do that, but this is what we in this method you get this red curve here. And this illustrates what typically happens with this algorithm, which is that it goes down very quickly at the beginning. So this is something that you, or at least in my experience, with any of the methods, you get something that works, that gives you something reasonable. It doesn't change all the parameters on all your layers. And then, but by this point, you may often have something that is good enough. Okay, then you keep increasing the penalty parameter, etc. Eventually, you get something. This here is SGD in this case. And now, these are our little curves here. And we use parallel training to train whatever many times faster. I think in this case, we use probably 12 processors, so it becomes, I don't know, 6 or 10 times as fast. This is this curve here. And you can also use stochastic gradient descent within the MAC algorithm. So you should regard the method of auxiliary coordinates not as a replacement for SGD or for gradient descent or anything like that, but something that simply reformulates your problem into something simpler. The problems that you have to solve, the steps that you have to solve, you can still use SGD or whatever. Okay, so if you use parallel training and mini batches, then you can almost not see it. It is there. Okay, so I'm going to be skipping some stuff here. There are many things I could talk about here that are more or less obvious if you are familiar with penalty methods, such as how to increment the penalty parameter and all that, but I'm going to skip that. Just I will mention that one thing is optimization, another thing is machine learning or computer vision. In machine to generalize well. So for that reason, you don't need what we often do in practice is that we increase mu whenever the validation, the error in the in a validation set increases. That way we can skip updates or okay, so The steps, you can do lots of things, warm starts, caching factorizations, things like that. You can ask me about that if you're interested in. The auxiliary coordinates, the obvious way is to introduce them as the output of the layers, but there are actually other ways of introducing them. For example, you can introduce or before the sigmoid, and that has different effects on the problem, etc. So there are many possibilities here. The algorithm will depend on how you all these decisions, whether you it is in some cases it is obvious what to do, in others related work. I just want to mention that the method of auxiliary coordinates is not ADMM. ADMM is in fact is just the augmented Lagrangian when you have an objective that is separable. So this, you can apply ADMM within the MAC algorithm. It is exactly what I described earlier about using the augmented Lagrangian instead of the quadratic penalty. The relation with expectation maximization that I just said before, they are very similar in the flavor of the algorithm that you get, in the alternation that it makes. Of course, the reason why that those benefits arise is very different. In the EM algorithm, they arise, the way that you construct the algorithm is, you can regard it either as a bound optimization, so you have to construct this bound that you optimize, or as an alternative optimization of a certain function. That's how you achieve in EM what EM does, which is this E and M steps. In the method of auxiliary coordinates, that comes from a different, totally different way, which is introducing these auxiliary coordinates and optimizing. But in the end, they have similar properties, which is the final algorithm is very easy to develop because it often relies on things that are already there for you or have closed form. There are convergence guarantees, and in practice it behaves, they both behave similarly, which is that they very quickly give you a workable model that then they more slowly optimize towards convergence. And they have parallelism. That was not in the original problem. Okay. Of course, this is also different from automatic differentiation. Automatic differentiation is just a way of constructing a gradient automatically that you can apply to a numerically to a given point. You could use automatic differentiation within MAC if you want. So it's not that one is a replacement for the other. But there is one important difference to keep in mind, which is that automatic differentiation into some numerical optimizer and set the line search parameter to do that. When I say that you have one of these layer problems that you have to solve, one of the functions, then if you regard that as a black box, you can simply call an existing code and that's it. There is nothing else to do. So for example, you may want linear SVM, so just do that, call liblinear or something, and that's it. You don't have the actual algorithm. Okay, something that is very curious is the following. Now, this is about model selection. Imagine that you have, for example, a neural network with multiple layers. The basis function where you in the layer of the basis function the regularization parameter and the bandwidth of the Gaussian basis function. You need to choose these things by hand. That's what I was saying earlier about model selection. So sometimes the way that is optimized is by adding to your original objective function, you add a penalty, a cost, which is typically proportional to the number of parameters, the number of basis functions, for example. And this is what happens with BIC, AIC, this kind of criteria. Okay, so interestingly, this can be optimized on the fly using auxiliary coordinates. So if you want to optimize that and you apply the auxiliary coordinates, if you think about it, what is going to happen is that the penalty here, that essentially counts how many parameters you have and multiplies it times a constant, that penalty, since it is the number of parameters, it separates over layers. So the number of parameters in your model is the number of parameters in the first layer plus the number of parameters in the second layer, etc. So when you try to optimize this directly with auxiliary coordinates, you can do something that is very surprising, which is that you can explore the architectures on the fly. So let me illustrate this with an example. This here is another neural network which has one layer here where we introduce coordinates, and these two layers here we don't introduce coordinates. So this is, regard this as a real basis function, for example. This could be Gaussians here, and these are linear weights, and these are another Gaussian and linear weights. So what we're going to do now is we're going to introduce coordinates here, then we're going to alternate between training this part in parallel given the coordinates, and then updating the coordinates. Okay, but at the same time we want to do model selection, which means that I also would like to find the optimal value of the number of basis functions here and the number of basis functions here. The usual way you would do that is by training, fixing N1 and N2, training and repeating, with a grid search over all possible combinations of the number of basis functions, which is very slow. So what happens here is that that can happen on the fly. Because if you regard this and this as parameters as well, that you're optimizing over, you may think, how do I optimize? They are discrete. But you can still optimize over them. It means that you have to do a search over the values of those parameters. So when you are doing the step over the functions, which means train this and train this, if you optimize over the number of basic functions at that point, you're going to be going down in the in this objective function. You don't need, this is not a, just that because you did a couple of things, it allows you to do the model selection within the steps. See is that, look at how many, what is the search is. You have, like here, let's say that I have a choice of 100 different values for the number of hidden units here, and 100 different values here. That's a space of 100 square things that I will have to train. It should be a total network that I have to train. When you do them inside the layers, then I have 100 in this layer and 100 in this layer. That's 200, it's not 10,000. And then I iterate that. Of course, the iteration means that I will be doing some exploration, but usually you will terminate much faster. So this I call doing model selection on the fly, because it is really doing model selection, but you just have to do the optimization once. And that's what is happening in this curve here. So what we do is we start with 1,000 something here, and at this point we decide to do model selection, because we don't have to do the model selection at every step. We can do it every now and then. So when that happens here, the model picks a different number of basis functions, which is here. It is 700 for the second layer, for the first layer, 150 for the second one. Then we keep training that for a while, and so on. So every time that we do a model selection, the architecture changes. And it is, every time there is a jump here, it's as if you were changing the architecture and jumping from one net a different number of hidden units, but you are actually optimizing over the parameters and the architectures at the same time. Okay, so now, very briefly, because you can see there is a lot of parallelism in MATLAB. If you want to take advantage of that parallelism, I described earlier, there is a for loop over the auxiliary coordinates, there is a for loop over the models. You change that into part form, and that's all that you have to do. Speedups that you can see in here for various models that I'm not going to explain. This is up to 12 processors, you get a reasonable thing. But MATLAB is not very efficient. The MATLAB parallel processing toolbox is not very efficient. It is, has a lot of and that you can find in this paper here, I'm not going to describe it. Over a number of machines, you need communication, you need to communicate something in order to optimize that problem, because the dataset is lives in different places. We do that by sending the parameters around. So if you do that, we call that PARMAC here. Then you have a truly distributed optimization algorithm. We implemented that in MPI, and theoretically you can analyze the speedups, and the speedups are almost perfect up to how many processors, up to essentially the number of models, independent layers that you have. So depending on the problem, that may be more or less. is for a problem on binary hashing using the SIF data medium point training set. The speedups are very good. They are almost perfect depending on things. If you have an even larger data set like here, then these are the speedups that you can get. These are you can expect a lot of parallelism happening. The first part, now what I'm going to do is go over a few examples in detail, working out through the maths, so that you can see essentially the technique, how it works. This is a little like, now somebody explains to you how the EMR algorithm works, and now I'm going to show you how it works for Gaussian mixers, how it works for mixer factor analysis, and things like that. So I don't know how much of this I will be about 3 learning features which with SVMs and logistic regression. Another one is about nonlinear embeddings like TSNE. This is interesting because in this particular problem, the step over the coordinates does not actually decouple, and I will illustrate that. And then the third one is binary hashing, which means I want to apply a function, continuous function, and then truncate it and get a string of bits out of that, which goes itself into some other function. This is interesting because that is not a differentiable function. The bits are discrete. So there you could not apply the chain rule there because the derivatives don't exist. Okay, so let's start. What we are going to do is, this is a one-layer problem, one hidden layer problem. Here is a function f, which can be anything. Think of it, if you want, as a linear thing, but it could be a Gaussian process, a decision tree, whatever you like. And then g here is a classifier, which is going to be, in this example, a linear SVM or a logistic regression. So what we're going to do is introduce coordinates at the output of the first layer, and the resulting algorithm that is going to itself, which is going to be some kind of nonlinear regression or linear regression, and training G by itself, which is going to be training a classifier. And for those two, you use existing code. And then there's going to be a step over the auxiliary coordinates that are introduced here, which we need to solve, and I will show you how to do that. So you can see here what the advantage of this is going to be. Once I show you this algorithm, only five. I thought we started later. Yeah, 10 or so. Yeah, okay, thanks. If you want to change, once I give you the algorithm, if you want to change the function f, you don't need to recompute derivatives or anything like that. You simply, the only thing that you need to do literally is change a call to a different regression algorithm. That's all that you have to do. Okay, so here is an example for an SVM. If the classifier is an SVM, here is your objective function. This would be a typical SVM problem, except that you can see that the input here is not x, is f of x, and f is some nonlinear function. So this is a complicated non-convex problem because these constants are non-convex. Okay, so here is how it works. The problem is nested because you have the nesting right here. If we introduce coordinates, then this is the first step in the algorithm. Now here is decoupled, you can see. The coordinates are capturing that output, and then I have this constraint here. So now I bring the constraint up to the objective as a quadratic penalty in this case, and I do alternating optimization. So if you look carefully, if I fix the coordinate set here and here, then these are numbers. This is just a quadratic thing on f, which separates f separates from the SVM. So I will have a problem here, which is a nonlinear regression on f by itself. You solve that in some way. And an SVM, which is here. This VM, you solve it by calling leap linear, for example. How about the step on the coordinates? The step on the coordinates, you need to solve for each coordinate something here. So if you write it down and you work through it, you actually can solve this problem. For the binary classification case, you can solve it in closed form. There is no iteration to do. It looks like this. You simply set each coordinate to something. And that something you can find here. This is the problem over one of the coordinates that you will have to solve. It looks like this, it looks a little complicated, but if you think about it, there are actually three cases. There are two constraints, two linear constants here, the one looks like this, one looks like that, and there is this point f of x, which is a vector, constant vector somewhere around. So if you work through this problem, you can actually solve it, and the solution is given by this ugly formula, but it is just a formula. You apply it and that's it. It's a convex problem, nothing else to do. So the algorithm then behaves like this. You train a nonlinear regression on SVM in parallel, and then you update the coordinates with this formula, and you iterate that. Okay, so I'm not going to, you get a model here that works nicely. It is comparable with nonlinear SVMs, except that you have direct control on the number of basis functions and they are much faster. I'm just going to show you an animation of how this works in the optimization works in the latent space. See if this works. To illustrate what I said before about the fact that the algorithm right there already has finished. So in two or three iterations, and then it continues very slowly updating those things, but it is already solved. So this is a problem with of trying to classify these three spirals there. That's the initialization, and those three lines are the SVMs, the three linear SVMs, which are operating in this intermediate space of the low dimensional coordinates. So what the algorithm does at the beginning is reorganize the coordinates quickly. They more or less move to where they should be. The SVMs fit that, and that's it. The problem is solved. And this is typical of this algorithm, this very quick solution. Here is another example using, that was a random initialization. This is using a PCA initialization, same thing. So very quickly it finds the solution. Okay, so here comparison, etc. I will skip over this. Now imagine that instead of doing an SVM, you want to do logistic regression. So everything I said is the same. The step over the classifier will be a logistic regression instead of an SVM. How about the step over the coordinates? So here is the objective function. This is the what you want to minimize with logistic regression, the cross entropy. This is the constraint problem, which extracts the nested part as coordinates here. And then you bring them up. In this case, we are using the augmented Lagrangian. So here are the penalties that you have. When you optimize that in alternating optimization, then, as I said, you get two very simple steps over the models, and then the step over the coordinates looks like this. At first sight, again, this looks somewhat complicated. But how would one solve it? Well, you can you can call a nonlinear optimizer if you want. Remember, we are optimizing over just the latent coordinates of each data point in isolation, so it's a very small problem. But it turns out, if you think about it carefully, that you can actually solve this problem. Again, in closed form, the solution looks like this, where there is a value t here, which is solving this scalar equation. So if you do that, the problem is solved, exactly, because it is convex. Okay, so again, this works reasonably well. I'm going to move now to another example. So this is the parametric nonlinear embeddings that I said before. I'm going to skip over this because I'm running out of time. But this essentially tries to optimize something like TSNE or the elastic embedding, which are objective functions over coordinates of pairs of points. So this is a pair of points here. These problems are very difficult to optimize, but in recent years there have been some algorithms that do well with these things. So if you want, instead of finding the coordinates, you want to find a function, an out-of-sample function, then you can stick the function here. And in here, actually, it is very obvious what to do to use coordinates. The coordinates are going to be those low-dimensional projections. So if you do that, what happens in this algorithm is that you alternate between two things. One is a nonlinear regression over a neural network or something like that, and the other step is a nonlinear embedding, which I just told you that even though it is difficult, there are algorithms that solve that for you. So you don't have to worry about that. If you want to run TSNE with a neural network, then you alternate between fitting a neural network by itself and an TSNE by itself. If you don't like the neural network, you want to try a linear function, then the only thing that you have to do is change a call to something that trains a linear function. You don't have to compute anything else. Okay, and then the so here is an animation of this as well. This is how the initial embedding looks like and how it slowly distorts itself to fit what a neural network can actually produce. And in each alternation there, you are just computing, as I say, fitting a neural network and doing a TSNE. Okay, so I will finish now with the last example very quickly, which is about binary hashing. This is interesting because we don't have derivatives here. So in binary hashing, what you want to do is you take an image as a vector of pixels or features or whatever, and you want to map it, maybe linearly, maybe non-linearly, to some other space to get a small number of real values that then you truncate to get a string of binary digits. The reason for doing that is that then you can search that string very quickly in a database. Okay. The problem, however, is that optimizing that is crazy because think about it. Your objective function is going to depend on the output of these things, which are either 0 or 1. So that means that your objective function is piecewise constant in your space, and that means that the gradient of that is either 0 if you are in one of the constant regions, or otherwise it doesn't exist. So that's not something that you can compute a gradient on. And the way that this is typically optimized in binary hashing is normally by relaxing the values to be real, and then at the very end you truncate, which works to some extent, but it's suboptimal. So you can do this better here by introducing coordinates. So there are two models that I consider here. One is the binary autoencoder, and the other one is affinity-based functions. The binary autoencoder works like this. Here is this looks like an autoencoder objective function, except that this H function here is our hash function whose output are bits. So this is the function that I said that is piecewise constant. Okay, H is the encoder, F is the decoder. You can put anything that you like here. And I mean literally you can put anything. You can make this linear, neural network, whatever. So when you introduce coordinates like this, now these coordinates set are binary. They are vectors that consist of zeros and ones. When you bring them to the objective function, you have your penalty here, and then when you alternate, you get something that we already have seen a few times in this presentation, except that the step over the coordinates here is a binary optimization. So the difficulty of the problem, the difficulty that I said that you don't have derivatives and all that, here gets confined to within the step over the coordinate set. The other two things here that you get, you can solve easily by training classifiers or by doing a regression. The problem is with the coordinates. So this problem now is difficult. This is a binary optimization over L variables. Those problems are NP-complete, but it's just L variables. So L here is a very small number. It's the number of bits for one data point. This could be 10, it could be 30. So if it is small enough, an NP-complete problem is not a problem because you simply enumerate the solutions and solve it. If you cannot do that because there are still too many variables, then you can do alternating optimization or something like that. But these are very small problems. Okay, so thanks to that, we can actually alternate, and what the algorithm does is train some classifiers and then update the binary codes and iterate. Okay, so this does indeed improve the training error considerably over relaxing and things like that, and it also improves the precision. You can do the same when instead of having the autoencoder objective function, you have an affinity-based objective function which compares codes of two points. So you take two points, and if you decide that they are neighbors, then you have some penalty here for their distance being big. Then you can do exactly the same thing. You can introduce coordinates here. Here is your problem. And what happens now is that the step over the coordinates does not decouple. So this is much more difficult. And the reason why it doesn't decouple is because you can see here that they appear in pairs. So then in the step, once I have introduced coordinates, they appear in pairs here. And that doesn't go away. So they are not decoupled as in the case of the binary autoencoder. And that's just because the objective function is like that. You can still, however, try to solve this. You can think of this as essentially a very complicated Markov random field where the ith bit of each code is like the ith pixel of an image. It can be 0 or 1. So you can apply algorithms that solve Markov random fields as the step in the over the coordinates here, and it's not great, but it works to some extent, and then iterating that gives you a reasonable result. Okay, so I know I need to finish, so I will skip over that. But here we show that we can indeed improve considerably over using relaxation or something like that. Okay, and the reason why that happens, by the way, is that if you simply optimize over the codes independently of every regarding what the hash function would be, then this is the point. Can actually give you a hash function, like a linear hash function. It may not be able to to generate those codes for you. So these are the codes that are actually producible by your class of hash functions, say linear. So if you simply solve the problem over the codes and then fit to them a hash function, what you're doing is projecting in here, which is not a very good solution. This is the one that you really would like to get. But in order to get that one, then you have to do the optimization. Okay, so in conclusion then, I have described for you this general idea of the method of auxiliary coordinates that optimizes a nested function over all the parameters. The idea really is to restructure the original nested problem into a sequence of iterations within which, because of the auxiliary coordinates, things decouple in nice ways. And then you alternate between training the layers independently and coordinating them through the auxiliary coordinates. It has the advantages that the steps usually come out to be either solvable with existing algorithms or solvable in some easy way. And you can also often reuse code as a black box. It converges for the differentiable case. It introduces a lot of parallelism. It can work, as I described, with non-differentiable or discrete layers, and it can also do model selection on the fly, as I also described. So I hope this is widely applicable in machine learning and computer vision. And I will finish here. Thanks.